Don't you think so? It's a wonderful thing to close your eyes and you sleep, and the following morning you can open your eyes and you can see. The only person that can do that is God. Not even you can do that. You can only think in your mind that I'm going to do this tomorrow, I'm going to do that, I'm going to do all of these things. But it depends on God. So that we don't look like the rich fool that has gathered everything that he needed. And he said, yes, let my soul begin to rejoice. Let my soul begin to rejoice and rejoice because I have more than enough in my barn. And God just came to him and said, you are a fool. Tonight, your soul will be required of you. And who will take all of those things that he has gathered? People that have not worked for it. That is why every single day of our life, we should give thanks to God. When you open your eyes the following day, and you see that you are still alive, just give him thanks because he's the owner of your soul. He can decide to take it anytime, and there's nothing you can do about it. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yeah, we've been talking about marriage since last week. And I want us to still go on and talk about marriage. And last week we talked about the foundation of marriage. Why God actually wants us to marry. Why do we need a wife? Why do we need husbands? Why do we need the Eves? Why do we need the Adams? I will say the foundation of marriage actually started from the creation of man, from the creation of Adam. When God had finished creating everything in the whole world, he said he needs somebody. There must be somebody to tend the garden, to take care of the garden, to dress the garden. And he created Adam from the dust. And when he saw that it was just Adam, he said it is not good for a man to be alone. Let me give him a helper. Well, what kind of helper did God give unto Adam? Let's see the book of Genesis chapter 2. Genesis chapter 2. What kind of helper did God give unto Adam? Did he just bring a particular helper and just give Adam? What kind of helper? Chapter 2 of Genesis. I read from verse 15 to give us more understanding. The Lord God placed the man in the garden of Eden to tend and watch over it. The Lord God took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to walk in and take care of it. Then the Lord God took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to tend and keep it. Take care of it, dress it and keep it. For the Lord God warned him, you may freely eat the fruit of every tree in the garden, except the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. If you eat its fruit, you are sure to die. Verse 18, then the Lord God said, it is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper who is just right for him. I will make a helper suitable for him. I will make a helper comparable for him. I will make a help meet for him. Suitable for him. Suitability. Suitable for him. Right for him. Good for him. Meant for him. A suitable helper. That means there is somebody that is suitable for me. And the person that is suitable for me might not be the one that is suitable for you. He said, I'm going to make him an helper. Not just an helper, but the one that is suitable for him. The one that will meet his need. The one that will be right, just right, the right helper. The one that is comparable, meet for him. The one that is suitable for him. When you draw a circle on the floor like this, and you need something to put into it, if you want to cover the circle, whatever you need to use to cover it must also be a circle. Is that not true? You cannot use a square, triangle, to cover it. It will not cover it. Will it cover it? No. Do we understand? Something has been taken off from this particular place now. If we need to cover this place, this cardboard, this flower, we need the exact size of this place to cover it. Is that not it? If I place something other than the size, it cannot. Will it? No. So God is so wise that he said, I'm going to make a helper suitable for him. The one that is right for him. So for every Adam on her, for every man on her, there's a heap, there's a particular heap that is suitable for you, that is just right for you. For every heap on her, there's a particular Adam that is suitable for you. If you don't get any Adam that is not suitable for you, that is not yours, if your Adam is a circle and you get a triangle one, it is not suitable for you and will not do what? Will not fill the gap. Cannot fill the gap. That's where the mistakes comes from in Christendom. Sometimes we are too impatient to get the right Adam. Sometimes we are too impatient to get the right Eve. Why? Because we want to do it on our own. We don't place it before God. And we don't even think twice. We just look at the woman, we just look at the man and say, oh, this one is pleasing to the eyes, I like her. This one is pleasing to the eyes, I like him. We don't even have time to go back and ask God, is this the Eve, is this the Adam that is suitable for me? Will this one fill the purpose? Is he mine? Does he have the characteristics of my own Adam? Have you created this Adam for me? We just believe that anyone can just fill the purpose, and that's where the mistake starts. The square will not fit into the circle. The triangle will not fit into the square. It's not possible. No matter how you try, it's not possible. And I want us to know that in that way, marriage is not managed. You don't manage relationships. No. Marriage is different from marry. For manage, you don't manage. You marry very well. The right man, the right Adam, and the right Eve. But because of our impatience, we run into the wrong Adam. And when you take the wrong one, what happens? You continue to struggle. You continue to struggle. You are patching. You are managing. You are struggling. You are patching. If you want to put a square into the circle, it will not fit into it. And what do? You are cutting it. You are cutting the edges. Cutting the edges. You are struggling with it. And it will take you time. But if you have the right circle, for the right circle, for the right shape, what do? You just place it on it. And it just covers it like that. So you need the man that is suitable for you, and I need the man that is suitable for you. You need the wife that is suitable for you, that God has prepared because of you. But when you go outside there and you just speak any header, struggle starts. That's where the struggle of life starts. That's where the place that the struggle of life begins. And Adam that is not suitable for you, that is not even approved of God. And you begin to struggle, you struggle, you struggle. But sometimes you even pick the right Adam. You pick the right Eve. Then where do we have the problem? The problem is that when you have picked the right Eve and you pick the right Adam and you did not wait for God's blessing before your mating starts, you are in trouble. You have picked the right Adam. Yes, you have picked the right husband. But did you take that person to God to ask God for his blessing? Did you get the blessing from God before mating? Did you get the blessings from your parents before mating? God told Adam and Eve, he blessed them and said, go, increase, multiply, just take over. Did you get the right blessing from the right source? You didn't. If you didn't get the right blessing from the right God, the moment you start mating with that particular person, God turns his back at you. He protects you, you don't die, but he turns his back at you. It may be the right Adam. And that is why, look, this is the way adultery actually entered into marriage. Look at it. You've been mating with this particular guy or this particular woman, this particular lady before marriage. So already the spirit of fornication is in both of you. You actually got married to that man. You actually got married to that woman. Yes, you did. But I want to tell you that that spirit of fornication has entered into your marriage and has now turned into the spirit of adultery. There's no way you can stop that man. There's no way you can stop that man because you cannot be enough for him. The same time he's mating with you, when he was courting you, he was also mating with other girls. He was also mating with other ladies, even when you were not there. The same thing he's doing with you, the same thing she's doing with you, even as a man. She will also do to other men when you are not there because you cannot satisfy him. But when we get married, on the side of the woman, we still try very much to control ourselves, but men are without self-control. You cannot. Sometimes he will just look at you and just think, it's sad that this one has become a basket already. I've been in this one for years. I need something that is more fair. That is the truth. Yes, the spirit of fornication that you have taken from outside will enter into the marriage and become the spirit of adultery. And there's no way you can but tell that man because he's used to it. Then it becomes uncontrollable. That is how it enters into marriage. But I want to tell you, a virgin that is untampered with, an untampered with girl, lady, or man, a man that is a virgin, listen to this very well. And they got married. They took the blessing from God and got married, and they married. They get into the home. This man is just meeting you for the first time. You are just meeting him for the first time. He wants to remain with you, and he wants to stand with you. Whatever trouble that you pass through in that marriage, confidently he will stand by you and say, yes, I'm going to stand by you. Why? Because you were untampered with. There was a friend of mine. She was a virgin until she got married. At the age of 29, 30, she got married. And she was a virgin. And she got married, a virgin. And look at the way God did it. When she got married for 6 years, there was no issue. There was no child. But this man loves him so much that he said, no, I know that there's nothing wrong with you. I met you untouched. I was the one that disguised you. So whatever it is, I'm going to go on with you. If this lady was already tampered with, the man would tell her, I don't know what you have done with your life before you came here. Even when the girl is telling her, but you are the one, you are the only one that I've been sleeping. I don't trust you. I don't believe that. I don't believe that. If I'm doing that, something else must be doing it somewhere else. I can't believe you. I don't believe that. But the man, even when the woman will continue to cry and think and do anything, do you believe that it's the man that's always consoling her and telling her, don't, I'm telling you, our child will come. Our own son is coming. Our own daughter is coming. I trust, I know you. And God blessed them 4 years ago and gave them a daughter after 6 years of marriage. Gave them a daughter. Last year, gave them a son. Now they have a son and a daughter. A very happy home. A man confident of the wife, saying, I just know you. I know you. I trust you. There's no trouble with you. I know the way I met you. I know the way I met you. So there's no trouble. Whatever it is, we are going to face it together. And we are praying together. And God stepped in. 6 years ago, gave them a daughter. Just last year, gave them a son. She was not in a hurry for anything. At 30 years, she got married very late. At 29, 30 years, she got married very late. But she waited. She waited. But these days, we have so many people in their tens already disvirgined, used like a piece of cloth and become a rack. And when we get into our home and something happens, begin to cry up and down. Even if it's the only man, there's no way you can convince him. He will tell you, no, I don't believe you. When I'm not there, I don't know what to do. And when such things happen in the marriage, who is to be blamed? They always blame the woman, even if the woman is not the trouble. They always blame the woman. So God gave Adam, the woman, suitable for him. If you can be patient enough to get the one that is suitable for you, you will be happy. 1983, I heard a song. That is why I'm so close to my father. You know all of these old songs. Bongo Sikwe, I don't know, from Nigeria. Bongo Sikwe. The person that was supposed to marry Miriam Babangida that had a child for him and ran away and went to marry the president, the musician. I've been searching for her true love, and I'll keep right on searching till I find. Nothing good comes easy, yes I know, but I'll keep right on searching till I find. I love those songs then, 1983, 1982, when I was still in Form 3. I was in the secondary school then, I was in Form 3 then. So I love this song. I never knew the meaning anyway, but I just love it because I was sitting down with my father and we